Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Duel in the Dark, a fighter pilot story of the Blitz, by Peter Townsend, narrated by Dennis Kleinman. Forward. This book is a natural sequel to Duel of Eagles, in which I describe the events culminating in 1940 in the Battle of Britain, the first decisive battle ever fought in the air, when the RAF fighters defeated the Luftwaffe and thus put an end to Hitler's aim of eliminating Britain from the war and leaving him master of Europe. The day battle over, the Germans switched to a relentless night bombing offensive, whose object was to subdue the British into surrender. Goering, the Luftwaffe chief, announced the progressive annihilation of London and British industrial and harbour towns. London itself was bombed night after night without respite for 2 months. The day fighter squadron number 85 that I had led during the day battle was, in the autumn of 1940, abruptly assigned, as were half a dozen others, the role of a night fighter squadron. I tell the story here of how we in the night defences, in the face of formidable technical and weather problems, tried with little success at first to help stem the 9-month-long German night onslaught, the Night Blitz, while Britain alone, save for her loyal Commonwealth and a few brave survivors from occupied Europe, kept fighting on at home as well as on many foreign fronts. I'm deeply indebted to the following persons and institutions who helped so readily in my researches. Air Commodore Henry Probert, head of the historical branch, Ministry of Defence, and his staff, notably Sebastian Cox, an expert on the Luftwaffe. Andrew O'Gill, librarian of the Adastral Library, and his staff. The Imperial War Museum, the Public Records Office. Oberst Hans-Joachim West, German air attaché in Paris, who kindly put me in touch with Herr Berthold Kruger, president of the Kampfgeschwader II Comrades Association, who in turn put me on the trail of Herr Martin Mammer, observer of the Dornier 217 I intercepted one dark night in February 1941. My letter to him was apologetic. I felt sorry for the harm I did to Mammer and his companions. No reply was forthcoming. Patrick and Penny Langrish, who kindly lent me the wartime diary of their uncle, the late Ronald Hawley. It was a source of inspiration, both literary and artistic. Pat Barnard, director of the Military Gallery, Bath, whose wide connections were invaluable, particularly as he led me to Ray Callow and his brother Johnny, to whom I am grateful for giving me many hours of their time, so that I could form a lively picture of how Londoners took it during those long days and nights of the Blitz. Although the incident occurred after the period covered by this book, Madame Durkee Kidley helped my understanding by recalling vividly her memories of the disastrous bombing of Sandhurst Road School, where she was a 7-year-old pupil. I should like particularly to thank Roy Minton of my British publishers, Harrobson Bruce Lee, senior editor at my American publishers, William Morrow, for all their helpful suggestions. To Dana Noy and my daughter Francoise, I am grateful for their painstaking work in typing my manuscript. I feel an undying admiration for the people of London and all the other blitzed cities and towns of Britain. It was they who, barehanded, did more than we armed men to keep Hitler out of our island. Peter Townsend, June 1986. They agreed on at least one thing, Hitler. The spirit of the British people enables it to carry through to victory any struggle that it once enters upon, no matter how long or however great the sacrifice. Churchill, visiting bombed-out civilians. I see the spirit of an unconquerable people. 1. Tropical Nights. Night had fallen on Singapore. In those tropical latitudes, the sun, blazing overhead all day, sank swiftly at eventide below the horizon, and day changed abruptly into night. In the brief half-hour of dusk, I'd made a few circuits and bumps to get accustomed to the flare path, a row of half a dozen buckets spaced out over as many hundred yards containing kerosene, in which a kind of wick, like a mop, was immersed. They burned with an orange flame which trailed away in a wispy cloud of black smoke. Each one of these crude flares was minded by a Tamil boy, as black as the night itself. His job was to stoke the fire. Sometimes an airplane landing too close to the flare path would fan the flares into a wild blaze and send the Tamil boys scurrying off to safety. Now it was dark. I took off again, this time on my first night solo, piloting a Vickers wildebeest, a big biplane as ugly as its African namesake. In the open cockpit, the pilot's sole protection was a small windscreen. The wildebeest's huge propeller, a masterpiece of woodwork carved out of laminated mahogany, churned the air, dragging the aircraft along at a comfortable cruising speed of 100 miles per hour. In a dive, you dared not exceed 140 miles per hour, otherwise you were likely to continue diving minus the tail unit. But the wildebeest, within its limits, was a trusty friend, for which, though bred as a fighter pilot, I formed a deep affection. Climbing away into the starry purple sky, I rejoiced as much in the immense feeling of puissance and solitude as in the smell of the warm night air. In Malay kampongs and Chinese villages, lights flickered. They were cooking the evening meal, and mixed odors of grilled fish and spices and burning charcoal wafted up until they pervaded my cockpit. Somewhere south, the lights of Singapore twinkled brightly. Above, stars crowded the heavens, their customary brilliance slightly faded in the pale light of the rising moon. I flew on into the midst of the night, marveling at that multitude of celestial bodies and feeling like an extraterrestrial body myself, at one with them. These were dream conditions for night flying. With the stars above and the lighted earth beneath, you at least could tell that you were the right way up. In those days and nights, men flew like birds. People sometimes called us birdmen, even intrepid birdmen. That made us laugh, though frankly we preferred to fly as the birds do, with the horizon before us separating earth and sky, rather than concentrate anxiously on the turn and bank indicator, a dial in the center of the dashboard whose two needles wobbled uncertainly. This instrument, with your compass and altimeter graded in hundreds of feet, was supposed to help you in poor visibility to fly straight and level. It was a hateful little instrument which perpetually conveyed the impression that your aircraft was erring in every direction but the right one. But give us the natural horizon, and we flew like the birds. That night in Singapore was the 1st of September 1936. I was 21 and supremely happy with my life as a pilot, dangerous though it was and far from home. Singapore was 10 days flying from London. My first night flight alone at the controls was a new adventure in flying, the career which, since the age of 14, I had firmly decided to follow. No one could force you to be a pilot. You became one out of love of a passion for flying. While in the exclusive Tangling Club or at Raffles Hotel, you might spend a blissful evening in the select company of some well-bred daughter of the British community, or, at the Happy World, in the arms of a lissome Chinese hostess, dancing away the hours. Your first love was for your ugly wildebeest, with its oily reek and the emotions it provided in plenty. A pilot more in love with a girl than with his aircraft grew broody and lost the taste for the risks of his trade. Flying was, for me, pure romance. The technical aspect, though inevitable, was secondary. I took to the working of the engine without too much trouble, because it was full of amusing names, big ends and little ends, crankshafts and camshafts, poppet valves and sprockets, splines and pinions and pushrods. They made music, as did the steady rhythm of the Bristol Pegasus engine itself, as its 650 horses turned that great wooden windmill in front. We trusted the engine implicitly, flying, as we always were, over sea and jungle. Occasionally a spark plug would blow out, but the Peggy, puffing like a steam engine, would bring us safely home. The technicalities of radio, on the other hand, were forever to remain beyond my understanding. As an 18-year-old pupil pilot, I had listened intently, but comprehending nothing, to our diminutive signals flight sergeant. At the end of one lecture, he inquired, "Any questions?" I quickly thought up some unlikely electronic hypothesis and put it to him, asking for an explanation. "That's enough from you, smarty," he snapped. Thereafter, it was only in the most simplistic terms that I could grasp the basics of the intriguing mysteries of radio. Meanwhile, the important thing was to know the right button to push and thus benefit gratuitously from that marvel of man's inventive genius. I mention this to reassure the reader who may be as ignorant as I am in the field of electronics, which were to become a vital factor in the air war. Both before and during the German air raids on Britain, both sides were vying with each other in a separate theatre of war, the Wizard War, as Winston Churchill, a self-confessed novice on the subject, called it. The wildebeest did not normally carry a radio set. We could communicate with no one either in the heavens above or on the earth beneath. Only by day could we make hand signs, sometimes rude ones, to a nearby aircraft. By night, when we set forth in flight or squadron strength across the sharky waters of the South China Sea for a practice torpedo attack against some complacent liner or naval vessel, we, the wingmen, still carried no radio. On such special occasions, however, a WT, wireless telegraphy set and operator were installed in our flight commander's aircraft. The wireless op could communicate with base in Morse code. Our job, not always an easy one, was to follow the navigation lights, red on the left wingtip, green on the right, of our leader's aircraft. The target ship located, this with all its lights burning, was no great problem. An obliging accomplice, specially designated in our formation, would drop a flare, or maybe several. Down went our flight commander, his wingmen following. The torpedo, carried between the wheels of the fixed undercarriage, was fitted, of course, with a dummy warhead. We would put her in at 25 feet above the surface. This somewhat hazardous task accomplished, we would then look up, searching among the myriad stars for two special ones, the red and green lights of our leader. With luck, we would join up with him and follow him home. Otherwise, we would have to make it back to base alone on a compass course. Fortunately, the lights of Singapore, of the Happy World and other fun spots burned late and were visible, at least in good weather, from afar. Disregarding our compass and with a passing thought for an evening off duty on the morrow, we would steer toward them. Such was the uncomplicated nature of radio and air navigation in the mid-30s, at least in that distant outpost of empire. If not highly technical, it was warmly human. 2. This cursed, hellish invention. I returned home in mid-1937 to Tangmere in Sussex, Sussex by the sea, as Kipling wrote, where the English Channel, there some 80 miles wide, had formed an impregnable defence since William the Conqueror 9 centuries ago against would-be invaders from the continent, as Europe was called, not without a trace of disdain. It was at Tangmere 2 years earlier, as a 20-year-old pilot officer, that I joined No. 1 Fighter Squadron. This time I went to No. 43, No. 1's sister. Both squadrons had shared the base for many years. Some 60 miles south of London, Tangmere was one of the 7-sector headquarters stations in No. 11 Fighter Group. Little appeared to have changed there. The usual crop of hay had been taken off the airfield, a broad meadow unspoiled by any runway where sheep now peacefully grazed. Grass airfields, some more undulating and uneven than others, were the rule and brought a pleasant pastoral serenity to our otherwise exciting lives, though admittedly they had their practical drawbacks, the hay crop and the grazing sheep among them. Worse, for it was unredeemed by any touch of romance, was mud, which clogged the air intake and radiator of the Rolls-Royce Kestrel engine, which powered our Hawker Fury biplane fighters, which were nimble as birds in the air, but which on the ground, without brakes, could sometimes make a fool of you. Painted a gleaming silver, top wing and fuselage decorated with the squadron's markings, a flaming red triangle for No. 1, a black and white checkerboard for No. 43, they stood, neatly parked, in front of the hangars. These, with their gently curving roofs and wooden beams, gave delightful old-world feeling to this peaceful place. They were built by German prisoners in World War I. In World War II, German airmen would demolish them with bombs. Yet for all the familiarity of Tangmere, I was struck by one unusual feature. The place was full of new young faces, many more than in the past. Moreover, Tangmere was no longer purely a fighter station. A coastal reconnaissance squadron, number 217, with twin-motor Avro Anson's, had come to roost there. The RAF's expansion was now urgently underway in face of the German Luftwaffe's enormous and ever-growing strength. As long ago as 1934, Churchill, then MP for Epping, had warned Parliament, "We are vulnerable as we have never been before. This cursed hellish invention and development of air power has revolutionized our position." At the time, he had faced jeers and insults. Medieval baron, warmonger. Now people were listening to him. He sat on the Air Defense Research Committee and knew better than anyone Britain's urgent need to modernize and strengthen our air defenses. The most pressing need of all was to devise a scientific method of detecting hostile aircraft approaching our shores. Crude experiments had been made in 1934 with two huge sound locators near the Kent coast, but a year later Dr. Robert Watson Watt, already known as a brilliant physicist, came up with the answer. High-frequency radio beams, actually discovered some four decades earlier. Watson Watt immediately went to work on a system with the cover name of Radio Direction Finding, or RDF, soon to be called radar. The building began of 20 chain home CH radar stations, stretching along the coast from the Orkneys to the Isle of Wight. It was one thing to detect hostile aircraft at long range, another to guide our fighters to within sighting distance of them. This side of the business was entrusted to Fighter Command's new chief, Air Marshal Sir Hugh Dowding. He set up a telephonic network, linking the coastal radar stations with the operations room at Fighter Command headquarters, thence to each of its six group headquarters, and from them down to each of their sector operations rooms. Thus, the enemy plots, first seen on the coastal station's radar screen and reported by telephone to Fighter Command, could be replotted a few moments later on the operations map at the sector station, where the fighter squadrons waited, ready to go, guided to the hostile by the sector controller's radio telephony, RT. Though yet far from complete, the system was unique in the world. In its embryonic form, the air defense system was put to the test during the air exercises on August 5 through 7, 1937. Although operating with only three radar stations widely spaced on the east and southeast coast, and with its meager force of obsolete biplane fighters, Fighter Command was satisfied that the results looked promising. Yet 7 months later, in March 1938, no more than five radar stations were ready on watch when Hitler's Wehrmacht, with the Luftwaffe thundering overhead, invaded Austria. Churchill, the watchdog of Britain's defences, again loudly voiced his increasing concern. Britain and her allies, he roundly declared in Parliament, must choose either to submit to Hitler or else take effective measures against him. The measures so far taken in the realm of air defence were ludicrous. Britain possessed but a quarter of her essential coastal radar stations. Her fighter squadrons were too few and were equipped with old-fashioned biplanes. Delivery of modern anti-aircraft guns had hardly begun. To fill the gap, out-of-date 3-inch guns were being hastily refurbished. Some, it was said, had been commandeered from the Imperial War Museum. Searchlights and barrage balloons were in short supply, as were the trained crews needed to operate them. Barely 6 months after Hitler's rape of Austria, Britain and her ally France came to the verge of war with Germany, this time over Hitler's threat to liquidate Czechoslovakia as a political entity. But neither of the Allies, despite their protests, had the stomach for a showdown with a Nazi dictator. The Luftwaffe chief Goering was talking of the English skies being darkened by masses of Luftwaffe bombers as they flew on to deliver the knockout blow against London. British Air Minister Kingsley Wood was predicting 500,000 civilian casualties in the first 3 weeks of air attack. Cowed by the menacing Luftwaffe, the British cabinet authorized Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain to negotiate with Hitler. He and French Prime Minister Edouard Daladier met the Führer at Munich. On landing back at Hester near London on September 30, the smiling Chamberlain held aloft a sheet of white paper signed by Hitler. It guaranteed, he told the rapturous crowd, peace in our time. It also meant, though Chamberlain did not say so, the sacrifice of Czechoslovakia to the rapacious Nazi warlord. Relief in Britain was heartfelt. From the cabinet down to the man in the street, the fear of air attack was very real, though time would prove that both Kingsleywood and Goering were wildly exaggerating the effect of aerial bombardment, unless gas were used. This was always a possibility. However, the truth was that our air defences were in no shape to prevent heavy air raids, had the Luftwaffe launched them. Barely 100 AA guns could be found to defend London, let alone our ports and industrial cities. Searchlights were equally poor in numbers and performance. Both they and the guns depended for aiming on sound locators, which were practically useless against fast-flying aircraft. Balloon barrages were not yet dense enough to dissuade low-flying bombers. The coastal radar chain afforded only partial cover and did not yet perform reliably. Finally, our fighter force, Britain's first line of defence. Fighter Command possessed 750 fighters. Only 90 of them were Hurricanes, the latest and redoubtable model, but its 8 guns froze up above 15,000 feet. The Spitfire was not yet ready. The rest of the fighters were a mixed lot of out-of-date biplanes, like our Furies. We ourselves, once part of an elite force of interceptors, could not now even catch the Luftwaffe's more speedy Heinkel and Dornier bombers. Global figures, moreover, are misleading. Only about half of that motley force of 750 fighters would be serviceable, fit to fly, at any one time. And our night fighters, it was by no means sure that the Luftwaffe would not bomb under cover of night, as indeed it was eventually to do. Night fighting was literally as different from day fighting as night is from day. Special radar equipment, both in the fighter aircraft and for the use of ground control, were essential, save for the odd fluke, to successful interception at night. Specially trained pilots were equally necessary. In none of these requirements did any specialized night fighter force exist. In 43 and 1 squadrons, we joked about night flying. The night was made for love, as the song went, not for flying. Only fools and owls flew at night, and anyway our Furies were declared unsuitable for night flying, so we were not bothered. 3. This happy breed. If the Munich crisis found Britain's, not to mention France's, air defences still pitifully feeble, the people of Britain, not for the last time, demonstrated their will to defy Germany and, more personally, Hitler. The British public, ourselves included, could not yet believe that Adolf, who, with his proud strutting, screeching voice and wild gestures, was taken for a kind of music hall character, could seriously upset our easygoing, enjoyable way of life. Adolf had no lack of imitators who made us rock with laughter. Goering, with his portly figure, comic opera uniforms, and lavish display of decorations, seemed better suited to vaudeville. But his threats of annihilation from the air did, after all, strike home. It was the British citizen, the man in the street, his wife and children, who stood to suffer most from the knockout blow of explosive fire and possibly gas promised by that other Nazi warlord with his dreaded Luftwaffe. At no time did the British feel more that their home was their castle, nor were they ever more determined to defend it. In the 6 months between Austria and Munich, 500,000 men and women came forward as volunteers for the Civil Defence Service, as air raid wardens, firemen, ambulance drivers, dispatch riders, telephonists, rescue workers, and the like. The appeasement of Hitler at Munich, humiliating as it was, gave Britain nearly a year, the year of salvation, to press forward ever more urgently with her defences, including civil air defence, air raid precautions, as it was simply called, against attack from the air. The Munich crisis, when Hyde Park and other pleasant London parks and commons were disfigured by hastily dug trenches and the 35 million gas masks were handed out, brought the British people abruptly face to face with the dreadful reality of war, total war, in which the civil population would be in the front line. 6 months after Munich, in March 1939, the armed hordes of the Führer, with the Luftwaffe as usual thundering overhead, marched without opposition into Czechoslovakia. Hitler declared, "Czechoslovakia has ceased to exist." In Britain a month later, conscription, always considered an affront to our liberties, compelled 20-year-olds to join up. Their numbers were steadily swelled by volunteers outside the age category who came flocking to the colours. Yet another 500,000 men and women volunteered for civil defence, ordinary people who, in the coming hours of darkness, unarmed save with their courage, were to prove themselves far from ordinary. One such volunteer was Johnny Callow, a Londoner from Woolwich. Churchill had described London as the biggest target in the world and likened the capital to a fat cow, tethered and awaiting the slaughter. London's number one military target was Woolwich Arsenal, a huge complex of munitions factories covering 10 square miles with its own railway service and even its own little navy, for it was traversed by canals giving on to the south bank of the Thames. The arsenal was 6 miles, as the crow flies, downstream from that ancient Norman stronghold, the Tower of London, which since Plantagenet times had served as a depot, and still does, for weapons. Woolwich, originally a fishing village, succeeded the tower, and well before Trafalgar and Waterloo, it assumed the role and the title of the Royal Arsenal. Johnny's father, Henry Callow, got his first job driving the pair of horses which pulled, at full gallop, the fire engine of the neighbouring borough of Southwark. Then followed a spell as groom to the colonel commanding the Royal Regiment of Artillery, the gunners, whose home, like that of the Royal Engineers, the sappers, is at Woolwich, the garrison town. In time, Henry forsook the colonel's horses for the white horses of the high seas. He joined the merchant navy as a stoker. Young marriages and large families were the tradition among Londoners, though they lived, most of them, in extreme poverty. Barely out of his teens, Henry Callow married, and he and his Irish wife, Mary Ann, began during Henry's leave ashore to found their family. By the outbreak of war in 1914, they already had 3 children, Johnny being one of them. He was 4 when his father went off to sea again as an engine room greaser in the Royal Navy. Back from the war, Henry Callow signed on again in the Merchant Navy. He and Mary Ann increased their family. Ray, their last and 10th child, 2 had died in infancy, was born in 1927, about the time I made my first flight as a 14-year-old schoolboy and started along the road which would lead me to the Battle of Britain and the night battle which followed, the Night Blitz. At that time also, Johnny, now 17, was set on becoming a professional ballroom dancer. Though he had the warm heart of his father, he was physically the very opposite, short and spare and soft of speech. A natural athlete, he first proved himself during the autumn nights of 1915 when German zeppelins began bombing London, looking like silver sausages floating in the searchlight beams while a few anti-aircraft bursts crackled around them. Johnny's job was to run around shinning up the lampposts and pulling the little ring on the end of a chain which doused the gaslight. While this impromptu blackout proceeded, a policeman would cycle along the streets, a notice in large letters attached to his back saying, "Take cover." There was, in fact, no effective cover to take, other than the occasional basement like the one beneath the Tabernacle Church in Beresford Street. Even then, people were in no hurry to go underground. Johnny, like all little boys in Woolwich, belonged to a gang, no gang of young criminals, but a little band of friends united in their love of sport and fun, with a harmless dose of mischief thrown in, and ever willing to earn a penny or two for services rendered. Most of the gang were sons of market traders, squareheads as they were called, not because they were dim-witted, far from it, but because their stalls were ranged in Beresford Square. Johnny earned more pennies from strapping down the horses of the costermongers who drove their carts up to Covent Garden Market, where they bought their produce. So small was he that he had to climb onto a stool to brush the horses' manes, except when it came to old Ben, who obligingly lowered his head. Johnny, like his Irish mother, was a Catholic. Daily he walked the 2 miles to St. Peter's Catholic School and another 2 miles home in the evening. His parents had not the money to buy him a bicycle or a bus ticket. Poverty was the common lot of most Londoners. But they survived and later triumphed on humour, courage and mutual help. The Callows' front door, like everyone else's, was left on the latch and never locked. Anyone could lift the latch by pulling on the string which protruded from a hole bored in the door. Few families had the means to maintain their numerous children. Many of the kids were boarded out with relatives or friends. At St. Peter's School, Johnny was better than most at games and bright at his lessons, which on occasions would be interrupted by the intrusion of his father back from the sea. With apologies to the teacher, Father Callow would march Johnny out of the classroom down to the nearest fish and chip shop, there to buy enough tuppennies, which stood for fish, and pennies for chips, for the whole family. Then off they marched back to the house, which was decorated and hung with welcome home notices. There they feasted and celebrated the sailor's return. Johnny left school at 14 to earn his own living and contribute a few shillings to the family kitty. His first job was at the local glassworks. On Saturdays he played football for the Rose Athletic Club. Some months later he went to work in the Woolwich Borough Council and switched his loyalty to the Footscray Football 11. Then a broken collarbone put him out of the game for some time. His Saturdays were blank and dull, until his friend Jim Cassidy took him along to Eltham Drill Hall, leased on weekends for dancing. As Johnny watched the professional couples, he was captivated by their grace and the rhythm of the music. Here was a new kind of sport in which broken collarbones, his was still hurting like the devil, were the exception. It was that evening that Johnny decided to become, in his spare time, a professional ballroom dancer. His girlfriend, Kathleen, now in her early teens, was thrilled when Johnny asked her to partner him. At his dance salon in Bond Street, London, Victor Sylvester, the famous dance band leader, put them through their paces until they reached competition level. Perfect partners on the dance floor and deeply in love, they decided to become partners for life. In 1934, they married. Johnny worked on at the council offices, but on weekends the young couple took the floor in competitions all over the country. Rapidly they made a reputation for themselves, though at Cheltenham in 1936, disaster nearly overtook them. Johnny had forgotten his evening trousers. He was lent a pair so ample around the waist that the slack had to be gathered up and tied with string. Despite the handicap, he and Kathleen danced into third place to the music of Joe Loss and his band. With Johnny in his own trousers, they won the national championships. Foxtrot, quickstep, tango and waltz, they loved them all, but being a romantic young couple, the waltz, more than any other measure, made their own and the spectators' hearts beat fastest. Reaching international level, they took fourth place in 1937 at the World Championships in Blackpool. A year later, after Austria and Munich, Johnny and his friends, like everyone else, talked much of a coming war. All of Johnny's old gang joined up. His two brothers also, Bert, Silent Jack as they nicknamed him, enlisted in the RAF Balloon Command, and Alf, too young for the services, joined the Home Guard. Johnny and Kathleen danced their last world championship in May 1939, a month or so after Czechoslovakia was heeled under by the Nazi jackboot. Then Johnny discarded his white tie and tails for the heavy blue serge and helmet of a fireman. He joined the auxiliary fire service. His day's work in the office over, he reported at the Eltham substation for training. Kathleen, an accomplished seamstress, applied for a job at the arsenal. She was assigned to sewing up bags of cordite destined for the shells of the big guns, a daily stint of 12 hours in the danger buildings. Ray, the youngest brother, had meanwhile been growing up. 17 years separated him from his oldest brother, Johnny. Though Johnny was a Catholic and his mother's favourite, Ray, like his father, was a Protestant and his father's favourite. Yet Johnny and Ray were firm friends, Johnny encouraging his small brother to be kind with others, yet hard on himself, honest in all his dealings, and within his modest limits, a sportsman and adventurer. Many an evening they would race each other dozens of circuits around the block. It was fun and kept them fit. When Ray, diminutive but solid of build, took the field for the Plumstead Imperials, the sleeves of his borrowed shirt were rolled up and up again until his forearms at last protruded. His shorts, borrowed too, came down to his knees, and the football itself came nearly up to them. Ray, like all of his gang, loved cricket too. Their pitch was in Helen Street, the lamppost outside Ray's home serving as a wicket. Ray joined the gang when he was 5, their youngest member. They were a dozen or so little street urchins. The streets were their world and their playground, and they knew every bump and crevice and corner by heart. Old Man Callow allowed Ray to stay out till midnight, knowing he could trust his boy not to get up to mischief. Ray's gang, as Johnny's had been, was a band of young brothers united in sport and daring, and in good works too. Today, 50 years later, if you care to look for them, you may find near the Arsenal station notched in the brick wall by Ray and his gang the footholds which enabled them to vault up to the top. One after another, the boys took a run, then 1, 2 and up. Ray, being so small, could always be sure of a hand up from the boy before him. This was one of the gang's meeting places, the White Roofs, they called it. The other was the Green, a tiny patch of grass near the signal box some way down the line, and to which honour obliged that they should walk along the top of the wall, a 7-foot drop on the street side, a precipice of 30 feet on the Arsenal side. Whenever an army draft left for overseas, the soldiers marched down to the Arsenal station, brass bands playing and drummers in tigerskin aprons beating out the measure and twiddling their drumsticks, with Ray and his gang and all the others trailing along behind. Arrived at the station, the soldiers settled down on the platform, lolling among their gear for the long wait before the train's departure. The gang leaped one by one to the top of the wall. "Anyone want a beer?" they would call down to the soldiers. Having taken their orders, the boys slipped down again into the street to make the round of residents and shopkeepers collecting pennies. Londoners are always ready to give for a good cause. With their pennies, the gang bought the needed beer. Then, up again on top of the wall, they lowered the bottles on a length of string down to the thirsty soldiers on the platform below. Ray, the youngest of the gang, was the poorest too. There was always the problem of raising funds, a few pennies for himself, the rest for his family. He had two systems going. From the squareheads in the market, he collected empty wooden crates. Ray would tow them, stacked up on the end of a rope around the streets, and sell them as firewood. This earned him several pennies. The other system, just as simple, but requiring a little more patience, was to follow, bucket and shovel in hand, a horse-drawn cart. Sooner or later he was sure to gather a harvest of fresh dung, for which he always found a ready market. He took the pennies home as usual to his mother. Ray's good mother, whose first concern was to feed and maintain her large family, appointed Ray as the family shopper. With his sense of economy, he was naturally gifted for the job. He would memorize the items needed, and having rattled them off to the shopkeeper, he would invariably add, as his mother had told him, "And me dad's out of work." This would often bring him an extra titbit. Ray started school like his brother Johnny at St. Peter's. Then one day, in the middle of lessons, his father, once again back from the sea, made one of his unexpected entries. With apologies, as usual, to the teacher, he took Ray gently by the scruff of the neck and marched him off, not to the local fish and chip shop, but to the Burridge Grove School, a Protestant establishment close to home. As in other schools, the little ones were confined to the ground floor, the middling ones to the second, and the seniors to the top floor. Now Ray could play cricket in the playground. In summertime, the boys paid in a penny a week to save up for a day's outing to Margate. Ray, never having any pennies to spare, would, when the great day came, hang around the bus, hoping. There was hardly an occasion when, once all the fare-paying boys were on board, the teacher would not call to Ray. "All right, Callow, jump in," and Ray would wriggle into some narrow corner. After Munich, Ray, to keep up with his brothers who were enlisting in the services, himself joined the Boy Scouts, with at first only enough money to buy the woggle which held the green scarf yet to be acquired in place. Thanks to his assiduous fundraising with firewood and manure, he was soon able to buy the scarf itself. More weeks of saving, and he bought the Boy Scout shirt. Now he was prepared, like a good scout, for anything. Little did he imagine what that would amount to. Ray dreamed of flying. He began by carving his favorite airplanes out of balsa wood. Then, with his earnings, he bought kits of Furies, Gladiators, Hurricanes, and Spitfires. His father, impressed by his boy's gift for handicrafts, sometimes brought his friends around to admire Ray's work, pretty sure, as Ray was too, that the visitor would press a sixpenny bit into Ray's hand before leaving. After Munich, kits of German aircraft appeared in the shops. Dormers, Heinkels, Junkers, and Messerschmitts. Ray was glad to have them for his model air fleet. At the same time, he got the feeling that this commerce in German aircraft meant that things were warming up. There were other signs, too. Gangs of Irish workmen were busy digging trenches on Woolwich and Plumstead Commons, and bunks were being installed in the Woolwich Equitable Insurance Building. In the months following Munich, on to the Czechoslovakian tragedy of March 1939 and beyond, civil defense wardens were more and more seen in the streets, with their blue uniforms and white tin hats emblazoned with the initials ARP, Air Raid Precautions. Air raid drills and exercises provided good sport to Ray and the gang. Only too happy to volunteer as victims, they lay prostrate in the streets, feigning death or injury. After first aid and bandages, an ambulance would cart them off to the hospital where, after smiles and thanks all around, each boy was rewarded with a few candies. It was fun for all, fun which would give way before long to dreadful reality. Dark clouds were gathering. After Czechoslovakia, people began to brace themselves against the threatening storm. In the Callow family, Amy, the oldest daughter, got a job in the arsenal sewing parachutes. Rose, her sister, whose man was in the Merchant Navy, continued to mind her home and her children. Melv, who worked in a denture factory, stuck to her job, an essential one after all, and Renee, still in her teens, found a place ushering in the Granada cinema. A useful job, she reckoned, for if war came, she could help in an emergency. Finally, there was the old man. He signed off from the Merchant Navy and joined up in the big gun shop at the arsenal. There only the strongest men could survive the fierce heat of the foundry and the 12-hour workday. Henry Callow, during his early days as a naval stoker, had acquired the muscles and the guts for the job. Thus did the Callow family, like thousands of others in London's boroughs north and south of the Thames, and in cities throughout the land, prepare for the war which, they were sure, would hit them in their hearts and their homes. They were to be the mainstay of Britain's night defences. 4. Preparing for war. With Britain redoubling her efforts to defend herself against air attack, Hawker Hurricanes and Supermarine Spitfires, 300-mile-per-hour plus 8-gun fighters, now came streaming off the production lines. In 43 Squadron, we collected in December 1938 our first Hurries from Brooklands, Hawker's airfield surrounded by the famous racing car circuit. By the time Hitler had crushed Czechoslovakia in March 1939, the squadron was operational both by day and by night. Yes, night flying was now on the menu of every day fighter squadron. No one had yet heard of a night fighter squadron nor of a night fighter aircraft, because no such thing existed. So we had to swallow our words about fools and owls, and in our day fighters, explore the terrors of the night. In its initial tests, The prototype Hurricane was reported to be maneuverable and docile. Maneuverable it certainly was, but in war trim with ammunition tanks full, radio fitted and camouflage war paint daubed on, it was not all that docile. It did not forgive errors in flying, particularly when near the stall, as did the gracious good-tempered Fury, whose conception differed little from the fighters of World War I, an open cockpit biplane with fixed undercarriage. Its two Vickers machine guns were mounted in the cockpit and fired through the propeller by means of an interrupter gear. The Hurricane, by contrast, was of entirely different design, a high-performance monoplane which demanded a cockpit covered in flight by a sliding roof, a retractable undercarriage, and wing flaps to reduce landing speed. It mounted a powerful battery of 8 Browning 303 guns, 4 in each wing. With its Rolls-Royce Merlin engine of 1,030 horsepower, the Hurricane was over 100 miles per hour faster than the Fury and a redoubtable war machine. Beside it, the Fury was a delightful plaything. Despite its mighty engine, the Hurricane, while sensitive on the controls, was not fitted with a rudder trimming device that would permit the pilot to counteract the powerful propeller torque. Consequently, in cloud and darkness, when flying on instruments, which included an artificial horizon and sensitive altimeter, you had the impression of pushing harder with one foot than with the other on the rudder bar, and the disconcerting feeling that the aircraft was slithering sideways from under the seat of your pants. In its early career, the Hurricane killed dozens of pilots and earned a bad name for itself. Another disturbing feature at night of this formidable day fighter was the torrent of flame which poured out of the three exhaust ports on each side of the slim pointed nose that housed the V-12 Merlin engine, blue Bunsen flame, the sign of perfect combustion. The Hurricane, not being designed specifically as a night fighter, no one apparently realized that the exhaust flames would half blind the pilot and obscure his all-important view of the horizon. The problem was temporarily solved by screening the flames from the pilot's view.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.